Let's consider the secret life of the innermost nesting doll. Living most of her life in the dark, inside the other nesting dolls, she has plenty of time to think, if she could. Sadly, she has no brain. However, when an innermost nesting doll hears that Geico not only saves people money, but also has been providing great service for over 75 years, she thinks it's obvious you should switch. Because yes, switching to Geico is a no-brainer. Pity the innermost nesting doll and her lot in life.
Your home is important. That's why Geico helps make it easy to save on condo insurance. Because home is more than just a place. Home is where you took minimalism too far because there's only one chair in your entire condo and your only entertainment is one card. Not even a deck of cards, but a single card. And all your guests have to share one plate and one fork, but you're convinced that less stuff means more freedom. The Geico Insurance Agency could help protect the overly minimalist broom closet you call home. Call Geico and see how easy it is to switch and save on condo insurance.
I'm Commander Shepard, and This Week in Geek is my favorite podcast on the Citadel.
Everyone has been destroyed because of this freak. I won't allow it! These babies just saved this lame death party!
And now, a thought from Geico Motorcycle. It took 15 minutes to take a spirit animal quiz online.
Please be the cheetah. Please be the cheetah.
And learn your animal isn't the cheetah, but the far less appealing blobfish.
Oh, come on.
To add insult to injury, you could have used those 15 blobfish minutes to switch your motorcycle insurance to Geico.
Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on motorcycle insurance.
Hey guys, what's going on? You are listening to This Week in Geek, otherwise known as Twig, the flagship of stupidity. I'm your host, Mike the Birdman Daw, but I'm not alone as I decide to bring things a little bit home this week to the wonderful city of Guelph, Ontario, Canada. I'm joined with my compatriot,
Alex.
That's right, guys. We are talking about some wonderful experiences because this show's going to run a little bit different. There's actually not going to be a whole lot of us in the show this week. We actually have a lot of pre-produced elements this week because we went to a wonderful local convention we're going to talk about in the opening of this show, and that was GenreCon 2019 held here in Guelph, Ontario. We had a fantastic time at this local convention. It's been running for the past couple of days here in Guelph, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. We are recording this on the Sunday. Unfortunately, we didn't get a chance to go today just due to scheduling, which is unfortunate. But these guys put together a fairly fantastic show and a step up from last year as Mr. Christopher and Lacey, his fiancée, had a chance to go last year and got a lot of interviews and persons on the street for us last year. This year, we had a chance to talk to some cosplayers. We have a special interview, which will be featured in this episode, with Canadian voice actor, and you may know him best as Commander Shepard, Mark Meir. Or we also have another interview with the game designer behind one of the local successful card games, which will be coming up in about a week or so. But Alex, this is one of your first convention experiences. What did you think of going to a small local convention compared to a larger one, like, say, Con Bravo you went to a little while back?
Well, years ago, I had gone to a couple local ones here in Kitchener, and, like, there is a Kitchener Comic-Con that is sort of in between the size of this GenreCon and Con Bravo in that it's hosted at City Hall, so it has government money behind it, sort of as a sponsored event. So that was, and that's usually more just like crowds and crowds of people buying crap from all the vendors. So that was more of a, almost like a toy show, more than an actual Comic-Con type thing. So this was, it felt like Con Bravo, but on a smaller scale where it's growing. So it was quite interesting. I mean, we if we had gone the full weekend, we would have seen the full spectrum of all the people coming in and out. But being there on the Saturday, it was quite good. It was easy enough to go and meet everybody and say hi. And they had a nice variety of different events going on. Was it the Stitch and Bitch?
Yeah, that room.
Where it's just you learned how to like needlepoint, stitch, or crochet, or there's like a loom maker, like with a loom thingy. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And then it's like geeky stuff that way. There were different stations set up so you could do tabletop gaming, learn how to play D&D. They had somebody there running you through like your first level. And, it was basically families that are sitting down, being able to, you know, learn D&D for, let's say, mom and pop don't know how to do it. And they've wanted to play, and then they want to play with the kids, and they made it simple for the kids to play. Then there were like video game room where you could play retro consoles with people randomly, as well as like DDR and
rock band
and karaoke. Then you've got there was the big vendor room, which Mr. Tristor said was about twice the size of what they had last year and a lot easier to navigate and move around. And that was pretty good there. It was all sort of tucked into the one section of the Delta Hotel, which was actually a lot more accessible, I heard, than what was last year.
Yeah, last year, I hear it was not so accessible for someone like me who's in a wheelchair. This year, I was able to get around to the vendors' rooms, able to get around into the different panel rooms this year. In fact, I was so surprised how easy I could drive my wheelchair through the vendor hall with no issues whatsoever. There were one or two booths I would have had a little bit of trouble getting into.
Yeah, the
I
ones
probably
on the
could
side,
have backed up, but
the Genesis one where Mr. Tristor was interviewing the team there, it was a little tucked in, a little tight in the corner there, even for like say two people to stand side by side. But that was that one section on the right hand side, and I think that was it. Everything else was pretty good, and that was only because they had to tighten it up there because the one back corner was dedicated just to the autograph signings for all the celebrities.
Yeah, and speaking of celebrities there, they had Brendan Mejia. I'm messing up his last name.
I'm going to say it's probably Maya.
Maya, he is the red Dino Charge Ranger. They had Chris Violette, who's the blue SPD Ranger. They had, I can't remember the gentleman's name, but he was white Dino Charge Ranger. Or no, sorry, not White Dino Charge, White Dino Thunder. And they also had another, a kid voice actor who's done some smaller roles on TV and animation. And they had Mark Meer. Mark Meer just wandered the floor the entire weekend.
Pretty much.
He's still posting pictures right now on Twitter and Facebook. And speaking of that, little convention story. So I ran into Mark on the con floor. And he's like, hey, Mike, how's it going? Blah, 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 blah. And I'm like, hey, I'd like to get some time with you. He's like, yeah, sure. Maybe we'll do it after my panel. And we show up to his panel. And he asked me, hey, Mike, I have an hour to fill. What are you doing? I'm like, well, going to your panel, of course. He's like, hey, do you want to help me moderate it? And I was literally in shock thinking, oh, my God. Yeah, sure. I'll just treat this like inside the actor's studio, except with dorks. So I got up in front of the room with Mark Meer, and we just basically had a conversation between friends that the entire room could listen into, and we took some questions from the audience, and that hour went by quick.
And it's one of those things where if it was a larger con, you wouldn't get that kind of an intimate setting. Like, it was the kind of thing where it almost felt like everybody was just, it was almost like you were sitting around a round table and just all, you know, shooting the shit.
Yeah, I mean, it was really intimate, and it really felt like the type of interview where you really get some personal stories. And Mark was telling stories about how him and Raphael, who was the voice actor for Caden from Mass Effect, used to goof around in the booth. Lines that got cut, how he did the Vorcha voices, how much input he actually had in developing some of the alien sounds of Mass Effect. We also talked a lot about D&D. I knew Mark was a D&D Mark, but I didn't realize how much down the rabbit hole it went.
And not just like, that, his comic book knowledge.
Oh my God. I was like this kid knows D&D and DC comics like the back of his hand.
He cosplays as random characters that nobody's heard of.
Yeah, and he has this huge thing for villains too, and it was so cool just to talk with the crowd. We talked about geek culture. We talked about D&D, fandoms, Mass Effect, obviously, voice acting. And it was just, it was one of the coolest experiences I've ever had in my life. And then you'll hear in the interview, we talk more about tabletop gaming. So be sure to be checking for that interview during our news segment, which will take up the vast majority of this episode. So coming up in this week's episode, we have some really cool things for you. We will be getting a review of Alex is checking out something called Space Runaway, which I think is an anime, correct?
It is an anime. It is one of those giant mecha anime from the creators of the Gundam series.
Got my attention. We're also gonna take the chance to talk about some news that happened this week. We're only gonna take one story from Weird and for regular news this week. Then we have an extended look at Kingdom Hearts 3, but also some stuff that goes along with Kingdom Hearts 3 if you're into the collectibles market. We'll be checking that out. We're also talking about some of the weird news and why stealing is bad despite how cool the items you might be able to get are. We're also going to take a jaunt down the Satan's Pantry, and of course we'll wrap up the show, let you know what's coming up this week, as I will have a special review for Alex for his Turd or Treasure show. But what that review is, you're gonna have to stay tuned until the end of the show to find out. So we'll be back right here on thisweekingeek.net. I've been your host, Mike the Birdman, joined with Alex the producer. We'll be back, guys, right after this and messages from our sponsor of librisarcana.com.
Space Runaway Ideon is one of those anime titles that may have flown under the radar for a lot of the casual fans out there. It's one of the mecha series from, you know, the height of mecha series when they were all being produced from the late 70s to the late 80s. There's plenty now, but this was sort of the golden age, especially for Sunrise. And this is a series that ran for 39 episodes. It has two movies involved. And what they are is there's a movie that is, the first one is sort of a one of those things where they combine a bunch of episodes and then change some of the shots and the composition of it to make a movie introduction. And then the second movie, the show was canceled a little early and they had to alter sort of how they wanted the show to end that way. Well, the movie is a compilation of, you know, the ending story, but then what they also do is animated new scenes and made a brand new ending to complete the series. And you get all of these on 6 Blu-ray high-def discs. We're talking 1080p, fully remastered. Some of the video is a little soft in areas, and I realize that might be stuff that they had to pull from, say, like a master tape instead of something like pulling from a brand new like cell transfer. Some of it looks like it's taken straight from the cells, like they've re-photographed or re-scanned them, and they're fantastic. I would say overall, the video is about a 9 out of 10, considering the age of the prints and the animation. And it wasn't like this wasn't like the Gundam of, you know, where they were going to be restoring it and archiving it like as fantastic as possible. So it is something that, you know, you wouldn't have seen this good quality anywhere except for the fact that it was remastered recently in Japan. So this was originally going to be one of those SD on Blu-ray discs, the standard definition videos where it comes on one or two discs, just like Zabungle was. But then when a new transfer was made available from the Japanese Sunrise, they went and licensed that instead. So instead of being a two-disc standard def 480p copy, you've got a six-disc 1080p fully remastered copy with remastered stereo Japanese audio, brand new English subtitles produced for it. It's an absolutely gorgeous show, and it just brings back that feeling of when you were a kid and you were turning on TV and, you know, some Japanimation, I say in quotes, was being shown on TV, or you'd pick up a VHS tape to rent at your local video store, and, you know, you were just not sure what you were going to get, and then finding out it's just a fantastic, fun show. It starts out a little more serious than most anime of its ilk were, and then it gets progressively darker and darker. Like, there's fairly graphic scenes, even in the first couple of episodes, where, you know, somebody's head explodes or their eyeball explodes. There's children sacrificed. Like, it becomes a very heavy and deep series, and it's probably one of the reasons why it was initially canceled, because they marketed a lot of these shows towards kids at the time, and that's not what this ended up becoming. This ended up becoming a more Battlestar Galactica style show, like as in the modern Battlestar Galactica versus the original. So it was a much more heady, individual crisis sort of show, and it's something that you don't see a lot in something from the time period. Some of the Gundam stuff got into that later on, but for the early 80s and mid 80s, this is not something that you'd usually saw. So I would say it's worth a watch for sure. And if you're a big fan of mecha in general, you're going to want to pick this up, because a lot of these things, when they go out of print, they end up becoming very expensive. And if you remember what anime was like back in the day, you used to, you know, buy a singular disc and pay $30-$40 just for two episodes and 480i. Well, you end up with all 39 episodes with the two movies for roughly 70-ish Canadian, $40-$50, depending on where you buy it from in the States. As far as Canada goes, there isn't, from what I can see, a direct distributor, except that Sentai Filmworks is selling it as a seller on Amazon, and you do have to pay an import fee on it. So it brings it to about $80 or $90, which is actually not crazy considering what you get and what was remastered in it. And for any anime fans, you know that that's actually not a bad deal. If you're getting it from the States, you can get it through through Right Stuff and a few other websites that are going to sell it, Sentai Filmworks directly. And at that point, you're going to save a bit, especially if you bundle it with some other releases. So my suggestion is, pick it up and then keep an eye on their website for what else is coming out, because they're putting out a lot of these mecha shows on either the standard def on Blu-ray discs, or if it's one that has a fully remastered thing, they're putting out remastered copies. And it's sort of a golden age to be an anime fan, especially a mecha anime fan. So I would say check it out, pick it up, and you're going to have fun for the next, you know, nearly 1,200 minutes if you're going to watch in a row. But don't do that. Make sure that you actually sleep.
Need a new weapon in your battle against evil? Check out LibrisArcana.com for Canada's premier RPG dice subscription service for only $7.97 Canadian with free shipping. You can get a new complete set of role-playing dice from D4s to D20s delivered straight to your door. Dice themes are new each month and can be anything your mind can imagine and beyond. Visit LibrisArcana.com and subscribe for only $7.97 Canadian with free shipping, and be prepared to open up new worlds of adventure.
News on the march!
Welcome back to This Week in Geek. I'm Mike the Birdman Dodd, joined with Alex, the producer. Let's get cracking to some of our news this week. And, well, we only have one story this week that I think is worth really talking about before we get to our interview with Mark Meer and our extended look at Kingdom Hearts 3. And this one comes to me as a bit of a surprise. So, evidently, Netflix has announced that a new animated film is being developed by them and Nickelodeon. And that's specifically a new Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles film, tentatively called Rise of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. Now, there is currently a television series airing of the exact same name, but this film will not be connected to that TV series. Now, according to Viacom CEO Bob Bakish, this partnership with Netflix is part of the Nickelodeon and Viacom's broader efforts to tap into the Nickelodeon library of culturally resonant properties and produce new content for third-party digital and linear platforms. There's also going to be an animated Loud House film that was announced as part of this deal, though no timetable has been announced for this. I'm a huge TMNT fan, have been for years. I saw the new Rise of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles the other day, the new animated series.
The one that looks like garbage?
Yeah, I gave it about one episode, and to quote Mr. Horse from one of their other properties, Ren and Stimpy, no, sir.
Well, it's not connected.
I don't like it.
now, would they be going for a different market and maybe try to adapt it more close to the original black and white comics?
See, that's kind of what I'm wondering here, because they're calling it Rise of the TMNT. They could adapt the early Eastman and Laird comics, or even
just
some
colorize
of
it. Give them their different, like, they wouldn't want to go hardcore and make it black and white, but give it that edge. Maybe make it for the teenage market instead of like the 9-year-olds, because the 9-year-olds already have their TV show.
I mean, ultimately, if they aimed it for about ages 10 to 14, I think that would be the prime age. Basically, the same kids that are maybe watching some stuff, like, I'm trying to think what might be a culturally appropriate show. Not Power Rangers, so that skews a little bit younger.
No, that's the age group they were going for with the 2003 show.
Yeah, and that went over really well. And even the 2012 series, which started out kind of weak, got progressively stronger as that series came to an end last year.
If they skewed it a little older, let's say the ages 12 to 16, which is what the Voltron show is on Netflix.
Yeah, they could easily pull this off because the Turtles comics, they are violent.
Well, and they can have it kiddie enough, but then, you know, throw in some subtle adult jokes or some tones or stories that the whole family can get into without it feeling hokey.
Yeah, I mean, there's such a rich history of villains and good guys and bad guys, and if they really want to tap into the rich history of the Ninja Turtles, I mean, they could show, like, not just them fighting the Shredder, which obviously, if it's Rise of the TMNT, it's going to be them fighting the Foot Clan. That's just given that name, they're not. You might see a cameo from Baxter Stockman. You'll probably see Bebop and Rocksteady in some capacity, but it's primarily going to be ninja on ninja action, in my opinion. This is all speculation right now.
Or were they going?
I don't think is a terrible thing.
Do you think they might do the thing where it's actually they only show up in the last 20 minutes and the whole rise of it is Splinter at first?
Well, you know what? If they dedicated the first 20 minutes to the story of Hamato Yoshi and him with Oroko Saki in Japan, kind of like how they kind of hinted at in the first Ninja Turtle movie that came out in the 90s.
Yeah.
I don't think that would be terrible, because the 2012 series delved a lot back into that relationship. They kept touching upon it and referencing it back via flashback. It worked out really, really well and gave that narrative something to really, really kind of go for. So depending on who's writing this, if it's someone who has a real love of the property, and because it is on Netflix, they can get away with a lot more and they'll get direct viewer numbers rather than relying on Nielsen, which I feel are unreliable at best. Netflix, they know what you're watching, though they never officially release those numbers unless it happens to be spectacularly huge.
Yeah, when they say, oh, 90% of subscribers have seen an episode of Stranger Things, that's like 90 million people.
Exactly.
So, you know, like, that's an unbelievable, that's numbers like they used to get on cable, or not cable, like broadcast in the 70s.
Yeah, like, and I think it's smart for them to go with a platform like Netflix, because they're not going to be beholden to anybody but Netflix, and Netflix lets people get away with a lot more. Like you mentioned, Voltron Legendary Defender is doing really well. Stranger Things is doing really well. And there's other properties that Nickelodeon holds that may potentially get better. A Loud House film, I felt a little bit a strange choice. I would have went with, say, SpongeBob SquarePants.
I am kind of surprised that it's not going to CBS All Access, because I believe Paramount and Viacom are the same company.
Mm-hmm.
And Viacom owns Nickelodeon. So
yeah, that is a little strange.
Because, like, just, it's not, I'm not trying to go off on a tangent, but, like, I'd signed up for CBS All Access now that it's available in Canada to try for the first month. You get 1 month free.
Mm-hmm.
It's only $4.99. It's actually cheaper in Canada than it is in the States, but it has no Star Trek. It has nothing that they have deals with Crave or Amazon are available on there. So it's like a third of the content.
So it's bare bones, but it's there.
Yeah. Anything that they've made that's exclusive to them that isn't Star Trek related is on there, which is cool. And then they have back catalogs of some shows, but it's very bare bones. Like, it's like the Crackle service was here before Sony shut that down.
Like, we in Canada, for example, our Nickelodeon is not the same as the Nickelodeon you get in the,
exactly,
in the United States. And what I mean by that is, and I found this out very much to my dismay, Earlier this summer, they aired a Power Rangers special called Dimensions in Danger, which was the 25th anniversary special. Supposed to be basically great value Shattered Dimensions, which was stupid hype for me. And it was supposed to air in primetime. So I have this awesome cable package, and I have Nickelodeon, but up here in Canada. So I'm like, all right, cool. And I get a rerun of Fairly Odd Parents. Because, and I'm like, what's going on with this? And it's because the Canadian rebroadcast is not the same.
Well, it's because I don't think they have Power Rangers license in Canada. I still think that's
Teletoon and YTV have it.
Yes, and because YTV has had it since 1993.
Yeah,
and they've never dropped it. So because of that, and because that channel in Canada is not owned by the same parent company.
Yeah, so it's kind of strange, but that's us going off on a tangent. But still, back to the original story. I'm not sure who I want to see new voices in these roles. Like, everybody who's voiced the Turtles before has been fantastic. Even the people that are on the Rise of the TMNT show, they're not bad. I just don't much care for the art style.
Just but have the Mark voice actors
themselves are fine. Yes, Mark Meer should be involved somehow.
To do everything. He should just play Victor Von Doom in that for whatever reason. No reason at all.
I'm trying to think if the Turtles have crossed with a Marvel property. I actually don't know the answer to that. I know they've crossed with like Batman in canon, but I don't know whether they've crossed with Spider-Man or anybody, because they both live in New York. So anyway. That's that story. So I don't know who I'd want to see cast. All I know is I want to see a good writer behind it, a good director, and someone who has a really good visual style, especially since we've now seen what can be accomplished with Voltron, Legendary Defender, and in terms of cinematic stuff, now that we've seen what can be accomplished with hypercomputer animation with Into the Spider-Verse. Yeah. I have a feeling we're going to see a lot more of that stuff in the media of animation for the next 2 to 3 years. Guaranteed, a lot of movies will look like that.
Personally, I would like a studio that... Remember the studio that handled Martin Mystery back in the day?
Yes.
That I think it was a French or French-Canadian studio. Something like that, like a pseudo-anime style, but still very well-drawn. Everything seems to be going this Steven Universe garbage look. And it's... Steven Universe, whether you like the content, which, you know, it's been praised for content, that's fine. The actual art style is terrible, and they're constantly going off model. They're like, one scene somebody's the right size, another scene somebody's a different size. There's entire internet memes out there about how terrible the show is drawn, and I feel like people are doing that now because that show is critically acclaimed. They think, oh, that means every show should look like this.
Well, it all began with the kind of Gravity Falls look, so I wonder if they share a production designer. Maybe. Do not know.
Gravity Falls personally, actually, is very well done, though. It's the same team that made the new DuckTales.
Yeah.
If you can keep your art style consistent, it'll be good. That's all that matters.
Yeah, and that's what I don't like about the Rise of the TMNT series. Is it doesn't seem consistent with the Turtles that I know. But then again, maybe it'll start out like the 2012 series, and it'll get progressively better. Depends upon the storytelling. So we'll have to wait and see what happens.
Just don't be Thundercats.
Yeah, for the love of God, don't be Thundercats Go. We're going to throw things over to an interview I did with Canadian voice actor Mark Meer, and then we're going to throw things over to an extended special look that we have for Kingdom Hearts 3 and accessories developer PDP. We'll be back, guys, right after this with the weird news and beyond. We'll be back right here on ThisWeekInGeek.net.
And now it's time for another special feature.
Hey guys, how's it going? This is Mike the Birdman Dodd, recording live on location at GenreCon 2019 in Guelph, Ontario, Canada. I'm joined with Canadian voice actor. You may know him best as Commander Shepard, but you may know him from some of his other work in the Dungeons & Dragons video games you saw most recently on the stream of Many Eyes, as well as Vampire LA by Night on YouTube. I'm joined with Mark Meer.
Hello, Mike. Thank you for having me.
It's been a couple years since we've actually had a chance to sit down and kind of catch up. And since the last time we had you on the show, we talked about Mass Effect. But even after that, we actually had a chance to play Terrible Warriors, which is the other podcast that we're involved here on This Week in Geek at TerribleWarriors.com. We had a chance to play a homebrew system I made up literally on the spot about Terminator. And since that time, role-playing has blown up into this stupid, inclusive hobby that everybody is into right now. So I'd love to get your thoughts as a D&D nerd, as a fellow role player. What do you think about the hobby
just becoming so welcoming, unlike anything I've seen before in history.
I think it's amazing. I love the fact that RPGs are so mainstream these days, and the fact that so many people play it, like people that never would have necessarily been introduced to them before because of the popularity of things like Critical Role and great ambassadors like Joe Manganiello. We're seeing an explosion in the amount of role-playing that's going on. And I think it's kind of a consequence of online games and people feeling like, say, maybe a little isolated. The fact is that role-playing games create community, and you're actually creating a story together with the Dungeon Master or the Game Master. I love it. I love the fact that it's happening. According to the stats, Dungeons & Dragons, for example, is more popular than it was at its height in the 80s. So there's the nostalgia factor for me, because that's when I was playing D&D. And just getting to see the amazing things like the Critical Role people are doing, the explosion of interest, not only in RPGs in general, but in fantasy and whatnot. Yeah, I love it.
Now, speaking of your own history, you said you started playing back in the 80s. So let's throw a little bit of nostalgia glasses on here for fun. Tell me about your first character.
My very first character was named Logan Bloodbrand. He was a fighter. He had, if I recall, an 1879 strength. So that was back when they had percentile strength. And 1879 is a little stronger than a vampire. So, yeah, he was a tough guy. I enjoyed him. He was fun. He was the very first character I played. But he wasn't the character I played the longest. My longest-running character was an illusionist by the name of Melrod Mastertrick. And he was in a Greyhawk-based campaign. They were located near the Pomarge. So he cast quite a few illusions on orcs and goblins and other humanoids.
So whatever happened to this character? Did he happen to live happily ever after? Was he killed by a vampire? Was he ambushed? Did he fall to a gelatinous cube? Or what happened to him?
He just went off into limbo because we just stopped playing that game. So no, he didn't actually have like a big death or anything. I think he successfully completed the last adventure he was part of. And then one assumes he just retired because I never played him again.
So as we are speaking about the hobby kind of becoming more popular than it ever has been, what do you think about the most popular setting right now, which seems to be the Forgotten Realms? What are some of your experiences with the Forgotten Realms setting?
Well, as mentioned, I did the Stream of Many Eyes, so I got to live in Waterdeep for a few days last summer, which was thrilling, and got to meet Ed Greenwood, the creator of the Forgotten Realms. And Ed was dressed as Alminster at the time, so I got to meet Alminster, too, at the same time. It was amazing. I loved that. And the Forgotten Realms, of course, is the setting for some of the very earliest voice work I did, which was on Baldur's Gate 2 and the various Dungeons & Dragons games that BioWare did and that Beamdog took over. I've subsequently gone back and done a lot of work on the Baldur's Gate Enhanced Editions and Baldur's Gate Siege of Dragonspear. The Forgotten Realms and I are old friends, though not the first setting that I ever played. The very first setting I ever played was Greyhawk.
Now, you mentioned some of the D&D video games. I understand these games are getting ported to some of the more modern consoles, hopefully very soon.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, Beamdog just announced that this week. They've gone into a partnership with Skybound Games, Robert Kirkman's company. And, of course, the Skybound picked up the slack when Telltale sadly met its demise. And they continue to publish the end of the Walking Dead games. So they have essentially picked up all the enhanced editions of the Baldur's Gate games, Baldur's Gate 2 Enhanced Edition, Neverwinter Nights, Planescape Torment, all those games. And those will be now available on consoles, so Xbox and PS4 and I believe the Switch as well.
Now, one of my final questions here I want to ask you, as a D&D nerd myself, what setting do you think has perhaps been underserviced in video games or perhaps in maybe books, maybe examples including, say, Dark Sun, Ravenloft? Because I don't think there's very many Ravenloft games, maybe one, maybe two.
In the current state of, like in 5th edition, yeah, there's just been Curse of Strahd, which is an adventure, essentially. It's not really a world book. And I was a huge fan of Ravenloft. The 3.5 and 3rd edition, I picked up all the source books for Ravenloft. And I think that's when they put out the most Ravenloft stuff, like all the gazetteers, every domain. I was always quite partial to Darkon as a domain, the one ruled by Azalin Rex, the Lich King. And so, yeah, I'd love to see more Ravenloft stuff coming out. That's not to say that there—I mean, there was a lot of Ravenloft product that did come out, and certainly lots of novels and whatnot, even a few video games. But I enjoy that gothic horror Dungeons & Dragons setting. So, yeah, there'd never be enough Ravenloft to satisfy me. I'd always want more.
Absolutely, same here. So guys, that was my interview with Mark Meir from GenreCon 2019. We'll have more interviews coming up on the next few weeks here on the show, but before we go, typically, Mark, what are some of the projects you'll be working on before the end of the year?
Well, I would be remiss if I did not use this opportunity to plug my television shows. There are Tiny Plastic Men, which is sort of a sitcom sketch comedy hybrid that is currently on Amazon Prime. All four seasons of that are available on Amazon Prime in Canada, in the United States, and in the UK. There is also a show called Caution May Contain Nuts that I do on APTN. The fifth season of that will be coming out in about a month, I think. So you can look forward to that. But you can also watch the previous four seasons also on Amazon Prime.
All right, guys, so make sure you are checking that out. So I'm going to throw things back to me, Tristan, and Alex. You've been listening to This Week in Geek. I have been one of your many hosts, Mike the Birdman Dodd. Back to you guys. Quack.
They don't really mean, really mean.
Well, I am 50 hours in and officially done Kingdom Hearts 3. This is the first game in the series that I've done through to completion. I played bits and pieces here and there and had family members that were much more into it and had played it in the past, like the previous mainline series. And my roommate in particular has played the portable versions and all the different iterations they have, which can get quite daunting when you look at everything. So as somebody who's coming into Kingdom Hearts as a complete new player, can you just jump in? Yes, they do include memory videos that show you the backstory. And to be honest, the story isn't really even that important. It's all about heart and blah, 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 blah. The problem is, the storyline is so convoluted that I don't even know if the people that wrote the game understand what it's about, because I sat there scratching my head multiple times trying to figure out. Didn't really care. I just wanted to see all the characters, how they interact with the classic Disney and Pixar worlds, as well as play, you know, awesome mini games and just control a great action RPG. And that's what you get with this. The story honestly comes second, and anybody who thinks that it's really important is lying to you. I've seen a lot of other reviews out there now, and you know, they're saying this is a 9.5 or a 10 out of 10. This isn't a perfect game. No, if it was perfect, it would mean the story made sense and it felt concise and didn't feel rushed. Now, at the beginning of the game, you're given a specific sort of goal that you're working towards, and by the end of the game, you don't do that. It veers off course very rapidly at about the 75% of the way through the game mark, and then you can tell that this was a title that's been in development for over 10 years, and they've had sections and chunks that were worked on at different points, and they had to restart certain aspects and tool certain things to do some other things. It's just, yet they somehow made it all blend together as seamlessly as they possibly could based on the development hell that it went through. That being said, it's still, in my mind, about maybe a 8 out of 10. I really, really, really enjoyed it. It is a little short considering how long a lot of Square RPGs usually are. If you're going to compare it to something, let's say like a Dragon Quest, that's about 60 to 80 hours, a Final Fantasy 60 to 80. This is somewhere in the 40 to 50 hour range to do completionist on. I did all the storylines. I did all of the extra little missions except for some of the final ones, which are like, you know, collect all the individual little blueprint pieces for your gummy ship. So, that being said, it's probably 60 hours if you do every little thing, and I talk about like every little thing, then it's probably about that range. Now, as far as graphics go, this might be one of the best looking games I've ever seen in my life. The only thing I can think of that I would stand up against it would be Final Fantasy 15 as far as JRPGs go, but the new Spider-Man was pretty high mark for system for the PS4 specifically. And like a Red Dead, it's not going to have the super photorealistic, but as far as feeling like you're immersed in that world, and I honestly think that the Toy Story world looks better than what the Toy Story movies look like. So if that's anything, it's just amazing. Just, I was fascinated by the balls, and yeah, balls, but literally like the shiny bouncy balls, they're so smooth. I'm playing it in 4K and it just looks like, it looks like something you'd see on a test render to show off what a new video card could do. Well, they just have it rendered in the game and it bounces around and it's all over the place. So I'm not going to reveal any of the plot of this because anybody that wants to play this, you know, it does. I don't even understand the plot, to be honest. You're just trying to be a good person, save other people. But as far as each world that you go to plays very, very differently. And a highlight for me was the Pirates of the Caribbean world, where it completely changes how you play. And it becomes very much like Assassin's Creed, Black Flag, where you're like going around and exploring, finding new islands, and then you're trying to upgrade your ship. And if you fully upgrade it, you actually unlock an extra ship you can use. It's really cool. And every game world has a different mechanic on how you work. So early on, it's just standard Kingdom Hearts, you know, you brave vanilla. And then as you go to the toy world, you end up looking like a toy. And you're able to control mechs. And there's even, like, you know, inside jokes to previous games like Final Fantasy Versus 15 that turned, or Versus 13 that turned into 15. They've got some graphics from that that's reused for a game called Verne Rex, which hopefully turns into a real game that looks really neat. Now, the audio in this is some of the best I've heard ever in a game, period. Because you've got all the classic Disney songs and Square Enix composers, and it's all mixed in surround sound, and the voice acting is really, really good from the Disney side. Some of the actors that are from the Square Enix characters are a little confusing or a little stilted. I think that's just a voice direction issue because it looks like it was all done in Japan and it didn't really have the Disney team on it. It just seemed a little stilted. Like, people talk for a second, then they all nod or go, yeah. Like, it just seems a little odd. But it doesn't hurt the game because, again, you're not playing it for, you know, a super engrossing plot. You're playing it for how it makes you feel. This is a game that makes you feel good, not that doesn't make you think. So if that makes any sense to anybody. Now, with the game, the only side thing I don't really care for is the controls of the gummy ship. I had to really tweak around with it, which is your ship that you use to go between worlds. I found it to be very unintuitive and very, very, we're talking, like, it feels like a PS2 or PS1 game where it's a little clunky and doesn't really stand up to today's standards. The battle system is fantastic, though. And again, the graphics and special effects, I don't think I've ever seen anything have particle effects this good in a game ever. So that out of the way, should you buy it? Well, if you're a fan of Disney, yes. If you're buying it for your kids, this is not going to be something they'll be able to probably beat if they're really young. This is, you know, there's tactics involved with it. It's a long game. It would be something you can play with your kids, but I wouldn't suggest it to young kids. I would say if you are a fan of Square or Disney and you like action-oriented games and you just want to see something that's a visual marvel, yeah, pick it up, because as of right now, there isn't any DLC. You know, they're not trying to make you pay for anything extra. Everything's already there in the game. And there's like a synthesis system. There's a cooking system. Tons of mini games in there that you can actually find throughout the different worlds that look like Game & Watch, you know, the old Nintendo Game & Watch systems where it was, or the Tiger Electronics, you know, the old ones. I had a Ninja Turtle one where you only can move left or right or up or down and you just press a button to do very simplistic games from like the late 80s, early 90s handheld craze. So there's those. There's Winnie the Pooh mini games that end up being like a puzzle bobble clone, which I guess it's owned by Taito, which is Square Enix, so yeah, that makes sense. There's just tons of little secrets and things to find in this, and then after you beat the game, there is post-game stuff you can do, extra boss battles, extra loot and things to find. There isn't a new game plus, so when you start a new game, you don't get to carry anything over, at least right now. That might come later on. But right now, after you beat the game, you can save and then rewatch previous videos or go back to the last save before the boss of the game so you can go and explore and do extra things afterwards. So I was very, very impressed with this. I ended up doing, I pulled an all-nighter to finish it off because I was just like, I gotta beat it, gotta beat it. So I personally can't wait to see if there's any DLC that comes out after as far as something to expand the story a little bit and give us a little more closure to some of the plot threads that they left open at the end. Now, to go along with this game, PDP, our friends, sent over a few little accessories. There was a Kingdom Hearts controller for Xbox One and Windows. It's very similar in design to like an official Xbox controller, a little lighter because it doesn't have a battery built in. It's a wired controller, but you can detach the cable. Comes with a 10-foot cable, which is actually really good. The rumble feature is actually pretty spot on with what the Xbox offers on its own. And of course, it comes with a black finish with little Kingdom Hearts patterns throughout it. You know, little hearts, little keyblades, Mickey ears, as well as the Kingdom Hearts logo in the center. It has built-in audio controls, which is actually pretty good. I plugged in my headset and was able to control the volume in it that way. The buttons felt pretty good. Not quite the same quality that you find on an official controller, but they're retail for like less than half of what an Xbox controller is. And you don't have to worry about batteries because when you're sitting, you know, in a living room, you're not going to be more than 10 feet away from your screen in general. So just having it plugged in was fine, or you could always use an extension cord. I dropped it between my PC and when I was playing it on console, and I found no input lag or anything weird with it. It felt like a pretty good, solid third-party controller. And if you're going to get one, at least get one like this where it's fully licensed and it looks pretty. I'll give it that. And again, the buttons didn't feel weird or anything. The D-pad is usually a stickler for me. I want to make sure that it's good. The D-pad is amongst the best of the third-party ones I've seen that aren't like, you know, high-end scuff gaming controllers or something where you're spending $200 or $300 on a controller. For something that, you know, retails in the $30 to $40 range, it's quite good. And I would highly recommend it, especially if you just need an extra controller for your PC that is lightweight that you can just toss in your backpack or something. They also sent over a series of Pixel Pals that, you know, those little, looks like pixel art dotted little light up, you know, figurines that you can put on your table. I've had a couple in the past myself before this, but I didn't know until this was being sent over that they have licensed things that are, you know, out of the realm of the normal. Like they had a bunch of Mario stuff initially, but now they've got Kingdom Hearts ones. So there's a Sora, there's a Goofy, a Donald, and a Mickey. And a lot of the other ones in their series are sort of based on Mega Man designs, it looks like. Like they'll take a Mega Man design and then just sort of change the pixel art on it to make it look like a different character. And that's a little disappointing sometimes, but these ones look to be completely original designs. And, you know, they're not based on a previous property. They're brand new 8-bit pixel looking dudes. And they light up pretty nice. You do need batteries for it, or you can get an adapter that lets you plug in a USB cable to light it up. But it's pretty good. As far as out of the four, my personal favorite would probably be Goofy. But I've always been sort of a Goofy fan myself. I know the other members here at Twig ended up getting the Mickey and the Donald one, and I've kept the Sora and the Goofy one. They're just going to be displaying on my shelf next to my controller in the game. And they're really cool. If you're a big fan of you know, little collectibles, I've always been like a Funko Pop guy. Some of the people are Amiibo people. This is something that's really neat, and I think, you know, I would love to see a whole shelf full of them that I could just light up all at once one day. But I would say for, you know, the price they're asking, you know, they're about $10-$15 or so, depending on when they're on sale or not. They're worth it, and I hope that in the future they start bringing up more licensed properties like this from new games and, you know, pairing them with controllers, because this is a really cool 1-2 punch. You get a Kingdom Hearts controller, you know, for pretty good price, and then you pick up some little accessories to go with it. So if you're looking to pick up the game, maybe for somebody's birthday, you know, pick up the game. Amazon had the game on for $10 off, so $69 here in Canada, so you could pick that up, and then also pick up a Pixel Pal or pick up the controller, and, you know, it'd be a really, really good gift and make somebody's day. So I am very impressed with everything Kingdom Hearts right now, and I can't wait to see what they come up with next.
What makes you qualified to be a reporter?
I'm willing to violate anyone's privacy for my personal gain and then claim with a straight face that the public has a right to know.
By the hand of Zeus, what manner of deviltry is this?
I love fake alien poop day.
Welcome back to Twig, your flagship of stupidity, and of course, who the hell's driving a motorcycle in the middle of fucking February?
That's weird.
That's asking to die. Because that's weird. And that's what we're going to talk about. The weird, the fucked up, the strange, the guy riding the motorcycle in February. We're going to talk about embezzlement and basically grand larceny because people are stupid. So six Ohio residents are currently facing charges because there's a scheme where they basically improperly billed Medicaid for more than $48 million. So the U.S. Attorney's Office says Ryan Sheridan and five others conspired to commit health care fraud in doing work for Breaking Point Recovery Center, a for-profit company that provided detox, outpatient treatment, day treatment, and sober living services. Evidently, this guy, Ryan Sheridan, is a flashy businessman and developer who's made a name for himself in Ohio for his collection of automobiles, which includes replicas of popular cars, such as a DeLorean from Back to the Future, the Ghostbusters car, and the friggin' Batmobile. He is currently in custody of the U.S. Marshals and is set for a detention hearing this coming February 12th. So I think Tuesday is when his life is going to suck. He also has a pending drug case in Columbiana County as well. They've also charged his ex-wife and a bunch of other people. Wow, just why? It's one thing to rip off jerk corporations, but committing healthcare fraud to me is a special kind of slimy. Well,
especially in the states where these people really need it. They don't have any other means.
Well, yeah, and like this is for detox, sobriety services, outpatient treatment. And that could very well mean people getting off of drug addictions, outpatient treatment, may also mean helping people like myself with prosthetics or physiotherapy or mental health services. This is just, you're making us look bad, dude.
It's really despicable.
Yeah, that's really fucking gross. And I don't know how else to really kind of spin it. I mean, I imagine the U.S. government's now going to confiscate these vehicles. They're going to sit in some impound lot.
Oh,
mind
no.
You, it's going to be the coolest impound lot ever.
It's not going to be that. They're going to take them. Once the case is over, they're going to auction them off. And you're going to be able to get like the Batmobile for like $30 if nobody bids on it.
Can you just imagine going to that to that auction? Coming up on the block, we have a replica of the 1989 Batmobile.
Oh, I already know what's going to happen. It's Jay Leno's going to buy all of them.
Actually, you know what? That's actually not a bad idea. And maybe donate. Actually, I bet you the Ghostbusters car, if the Ohio Ghostbusters don't have their own replica vehicle, they'll probably hold a GoFundMe so they can purchase this.
Does Calgary?
I know, pretty sure they do, or at least they have an Ecto of some kind.
Okay,
because I know one of my friends there, I've seen her pose a bunch of different pictures on different Ecto vehicles. So
because like it would be something for somebody like Jay Leno, who's known for all his cars, he could buy them at the auction and then, you know, donate them to different charities or do fundraisers or something, because that would do a lot to get his public relations back up from all the fiascos he's had multiple years with Conan and all that.
Yeah, I'm actually kind of curious to know what kind of other famous cars he would own.
Oh, he has like one of a kind weird vehicles. I think he has some prop cars and stuff too.
Okay, yeah, because I've always wondered who owns replicas of, say, the Mad Max Interceptor, and I know there's not that many people that do.
Oh wait, no, he has the actual one of the actual cars they used in Steve McQueen's Bullet. That's the movie where he's driving that
San Francisco, right?
Yeah.
He's driving through the streets. Yeah, that was cool.
And he's flying over everything. Well, they had to use so many, like three or four of them, because they kept wrecking. And I think he has one of the only working ones from the movie.
That's pretty badass. Because I remember you showed me the driving sequence from that on YouTube.
Flying over the hills, yeah.
And you're like, "Hey, Mike, there's no stunt people. This is good luck and hope you don't die."
Pretty much, that's what it was.
That's insane. Just to think how far stunts have come. But to kind of bring this full circle, I'm actually surprised how many people get involved in using defrauded money or embezzled money to buy geeky collectibles. I know there's this weird underground market for fossils. Like, I know someone embezzled money. I remember the story from a couple years ago, so don't quote me on this directly. But someone had bought, like, a T-Rex skull. And there's supposedly some international rule where you can't own certain fossils because they're considered historically important. Yet there's this thriving black market for weird geeky shit. Like, I know there's an underground comic market. In fact, on Facebook specifically, if a comic store gets robbed, they typically will post, okay, guys, here are the key issues that got stolen. If they show up at, say, the comic great authority in the next X amount of months, it was likely stolen from me, so please do not whatever. Or if you happen to see these walk into your store in the next little bit, they are likely hot. And it's so weird to think people are stealing geeky shit. I mean, hell, when I used to think of people robbing places, I certainly wouldn't think of them stealing the fucking Batmobile or using money to buy the Batmobile. I expect them to buy diamonds, wine, and caviar, not proton packs, batarangs, and other stupid shit.
Well, you know what? If you're buying bones and like all this sort of stuff, you sound like a Bond villain.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, go build your lair like... What the hell was the man with the golden gun who had the really cool volcano lair?
No, he didn't have the volcano lair. The
man no, with the golden gun. Dr. No.
Yeah, the man with the golden gun was Scaramango. And that was Christopher Lee. He had the midget dude in the
Tattoo.
No, Tattoo was from the show
Fantasy Island. Yeah.
Yeah, but his character in there was like Knick-Knack or Mick-Mack or something.
Knick-Knack. That's it.
And he fit into a cello case or something?
A cello case, and then he tried to stab Bond with, like, a butter knife or something. Yeah. It was so stupid.
No, but you're thinking of Blofeld with his, he's the one that had the amazing, inside of a hollowed out volcano.
Yeah.
With the cat, Dr. Evil.
So this guy who bought all the Batmobiles is the supervillain of the Ohio River Valley.
Pretty much, I guarantee it. Guarantee it.
That's so stupid. So that's what we had happening going on in the weird news this week. We're going to throw things over to Satan's Pantry, and then we're going to wrap up the show this week, and we'll tell you what's coming up on Turtle Treasure and the site this week. We'll be back, guys, right after this.
Welcome to hell.
You wouldn't serve it to a pig! It's inedible!
Welcome back to Satan's Pantry, where we decide to try the gross, the disgusting, the occasionally tasty here on Twig. And I don't know what the hell we're going to have this week, because God knows we've had some disgusting things on this show. From fried... What the hell is it? That thing that Jen gave us? Fried gluten. Fried gluten.
Which is apparently a tasty treat to a lot of people. And those people I call disgusting human beings.
But we've also had other tasty things on the show. Like, actually, I really like those kefir milk drinks or whatever the hell they were.
Kefir?
Yeah, kefir. Those things are really good.
I didn't have it, unfortunately. I wasn't here.
Kefifi. All right, what do we got this week, Alex?
All right, we have a bag of Lay's chips from Asia. It says pure tomato. It looks ridged again, but much more normal ridge.
So what does this mean? Just ketchup?
Pure tomato.
What is a pure tomato? Now, on the back it says Mexican tomato chicken flavor.
What?
It's pure tomato, but here's some chicken flavor. That's not a sticker.
That's on the back of the normal packaging, but the front just says pure tomato.
Lies. Right.
Well, I feel very deceived.
Betrayal.
This one's from China, as averse to the Taiwanese ones that I'd seen. It's made with potato powder, meaning it's not actually sliced from potatoes.
As with reconstituted
potato. Soybean oil, tamota flavor. T-A-M-O-T-A flavor.
I want to look that one up, whether that's a typo or not.
MSG, vinegar powder, glucose. Then what? There's tomato powder. They have that there, too. So tamota must be real. Artificial flavor, yeast, a bunch of other weird gross shit.
Nope. Google search for tomato says, did you mean tomato?
And aspartame. Weird. They have sugar stuff in this. Now, is this good for you?
Oh, maybe.
Hell no. Anyway, let's open this up.
Tomoda's village. Looks like there's Tomoda recipes, but
they're
I don't know.
Chips. And the
and the odor. Oh man!
Take a look with that. Take a dark, dark, deep whiff. What does that smell like? I have no idea.
Oh, it's like somebody dug a hole in the earth.
Like it's
something terrible.
I don't know what that is.
Let's see.
That doesn't smell like tomato. Maybe it's tomato.
Tomoko.
Oh, it's the Tomota chicken, whatever the fuck. It could be three or four different flavors that we don't know.
Potato chips. It says potato chips.
Potato shits?
Yeah, potato chip. Mexican tomato chicken flavor. Wow. Yeah, Tomota flavor
much,
seasoning.
Too much to understand. What?
They randomly keep flipping between English and French in the ingredient list. That's weird.
All right, so let me grab a little squeezy handful of these.
It's making me sniffle.
Ooh, we got a big one.
Yeah, it's kind of earthy. It's kind of bad.
All right.
They feel wet, but they're not.
Crunch time. Ew.
Oh! Yeah, that's tomato, all right.
Ew.
Ew. That
it
is
tastes
not-
like you grabbed a tomato
packet
and you rubbed it on the dirt. And then you just ate it. Just grab a big
they can't
bite.
Even get ketchup chips right.
I went back for seconds because it feels like someone took plain chips, squeezed a partially disgusting ketchup packet on it, and rubbed the bag together.
Somebody opened tomato paste and spread it on it.
Like your mom trying to make you discount ketchup chips.
Yeah.
Ugh.
It's like Ragu, but off-brand Ragu.
Yeah, it's weird. I mean, I don't hate it, but I don't like it.
I hate it.
It's not right.
it's not
an abomination
right.
against potato chips.
Oh God.
You know, the aftertaste
is disgusting.
I thought it was bad when you go to the dollar store and you get ketchup chips and they're just like nothing. You taste it's just like stale potatoes because they didn't put any flavoring on.
Yeah, they're
this
colored
is worse.
Red, but they don't really have any flavor.
Or when you open it and there's like a speck of red and you're like, no! But no, this is an abomination to...
Yeah, I seriously taste like I'm eating
Lay's
the green
makes,
parts of tomatoes at the
Lay's makes one of the best of the gold standard for ketchup chips, and they couldn't import that into China?
How do you this fuck that up?
Pure tomato
How
flavor.
Do you fuck it up when you are the main... Now that Host... Well, actually, Hostess, or Humpty Dumpty and Hostess were the main staples, and then they bought Hostess.
Oh, God, don't ever burp at these things. Holy Christ. Ew.
Wait, let me try.
Shit.
Ew.
Holy, is that not gross?
No, it went up my nose.
Oh God. We're ending this. Oh, God, kill me
now. No more. Please, no more.
Fuck up. Get out! And that's the kind of show it has been this week here on This Week in Geek. So hopefully you have enjoyed our extended look at Kingdom Hearts 3, Space Runaway, and also our very special interview with Twig, friend of the show, Mark Muir. Definitely enjoyed hanging out with him. And big thank you to GenreCon for having us out again this year. We will definitely be back next year. And stay tuned for the next couple of weeks as we have interviews from GenreCon's floor coming up. So coming up on Alex's Turtle Treasure, I did promise you a special review. And because I bought the game myself, I want to give you my impressions, my extended impressions, of Resident Evil 2. And the main reason I say I bought it myself and I pointed that out is when I typically do reviews for the show, I try to keep them between 3 and 5 minutes just because I want it short, concise. It's how I was trained, whatever. But listening to Alex's Kingdom Hearts 3 review, I want to give you guys a little bit more insight to my history with Resident Evil 2 as it's one of my favorite games of all time. And Resident Evil 2, here's a spoiler, guys, it's a system seller if you don't have it on any of the major consoles, but you can also get it on PC too if you happen to be one of those PC Master Race peoples. But trust me when I say it, well, you're going to have to stay tuned for that review to hear what I have to say. So coming up on the site this week, we have obviously this show. I'm currently working on a brand new botched role, and that's going to be about probably engaging your players as I'm working on developing the Cambridge Chronicles, which we are currently, as of next weekend, we will have between 8 and 9 episodes ready to go. Alex will be editing them over the next couple of, probably the next 2 weeks or so. So you should see content releasing, I'm going to say, ish. So do not hold me to this, by March break. And then we're going to just keep going with Shadowrun until we eventually complete our three jobs. That's all I'm going to tell you about the storyline so far. You'll have to go to the Cambridge Chronicles over on TerribleWarriors.com to find out. But be sure to check out our first season over there. And be sure to be checking out Terrible Warriors. I think they're playing Paranoia right now. They just finished up Night Witches, which is a World War One or Two drama. And that was a lot of fun, so I hear. I'm seeing a lot of positive feedback. So anyway, guys, what do we got coming up from you, Alex?
I have about three or four games in the works. I've got Steins Gate, the remastered edition for the Switch. It comes with an 8-bit side story, which is kind of neat. It looks like an NES game. I'm finishing up the review of that probably in the next couple days. I also have... we got a couple reviews in the can already that we're going to put out. I don't know when just yet, but they're recorded. I've also got... actually, I've got about two or three different visual novel games, because that's what's been flowing in lately. And I've also got a bunch of movies. We've got Youngblood, which is a hockey movie from the 80s with Rob Lowe, Patrick Swayze, and Keanu Reeves. We've got the, remember the early 90s Double Dragon movie?
I love that movie, even though it's so terrible.
Okay, well, we'll do that one together if you want, because it's got a brand new 4K remastered edition.
Fantastic.
We've also got Nemesis. Have you ever seen that?
No, I haven't.
We'll watch that one then. Nemesis, it has, what's his name, the transfers guy, Tim Thomerson?
Yeah.
As well as a couple other people in it. So that's been, those both are from MVD, the publishing company. And we've got... What else have we got here?
Actually, just thought of something, but keep going.
Okie dokie. I've also got a Kim Basinger action movie from the early 90s. It slips my mind right now because it's in the pile of tube review. and then there's an Astro Boy cartoon from the early 2000s. It's been released by Sony before, but Mill Creek just put it in a smaller package and released that, and I've never actually watched it, so I'm going to give that a crack. And then we've probably got some more movies. I'm still waiting on some stuff to come in the mail, but the weather's been kind of crap, so who knows? We'll see what happens in the early week. But basically, we've probably got about 5 or 6 movies and a couple games on the go.
Fantastic. Coming up from me, I'm going to be reviewing a Star Trek movie box set, which you'll be looking forward to that probably in this week or next week's show. And I have something very special to announce. Our good friends over at Insight Editions, if you follow me on Twitter and Instagram, you may have noticed I've posted pictures of the official Elder Scrolls cookbook. So for next week's episode, we will be trying one of the recipes. And that'll be a preview to our 4 or 5 part special of The Tastes of Tamriel, is what I'm calling it. And we're going to have sweet rolls. So we are going to be part of the meme. We're not going to take arrows to the knee. We're going to hope that nobody steals our sweet rolls. And that'll be provided by my lovely wife, Blair, who will be making those for us. And the cool thing about this is when they sent this to me, they sent it to me in a bound scroll that looked like it was burned and weathered. It looked really badass. They sent me these really awesome cake pouches things. They sent me all the ingredients except for the perishable stuff. But it's going to be awesome. We're going to have official Tamriel sweet rolls. I'm really looking forward to it. So that'll be on next week's show. So until next time, my fine friends, we have been...
Alex.
I've been Mike the Birdman Dodd. Mike the Birdman Dodd saying, be cool, be kind, be careful, and as always, live free or die hard.
Well, that's our show.
All right, here's the deal. Every time you watch my show, I will send you $40.
Checks will not be honored.
You've been listening to This Week in Geek, your source for guaranteed nonsense or your money back. Tune in next week for more info on the most important things you didn't need to know. Check out our website at thisweekingeek.net and subscribe to our podcast through iTunes or any podcatcher. If you'd like to comment on this episode, head over to this episode's post at thisweekingeek.net and leave a comment through Facebook Connect. Follow us on Twitter at thisweekingeek.net and follow our Instagram at twig_official_podcast. Social media not your thing? Send us an email at feedback@thisweekingeek.net. We'll see you next time, and remember,
lower your
your shields and surrender your listenership.
Just when you think this show is terrible, something wonderful happens.
What?
It ends.
I have to go. Somewhere there is a crime happening.
Ooh, sorry. I tried to talk and it came out as that.
I love the waveform on that.
When you call 811 before you start a digging project to mark underground infrastructure, you're not just making sure that your dig site is safe. You're making sure that your neighborhood's lights will stay on and that you're preventing gas leaks. Because when you ensure that your digging won't interfere with any of Orange and Rockland's underground gas and electric lines, you're ensuring safety for yourself and your community. Call 811 before you dig, not 911 after. It's the law. Learn more at ORU.com/811. Orange and Rockland. Everything matters.
The Starlight Lounge presents An Evening with the Progressive Box.
The moon. Yeah.
That's Hugo tickling the ivories. He just saved by bundling home and auto with Progressive. Gonna finally buy a ring for that gal of yours, Hugo? Send her my condolences. Hi-oh! This next one's for you, too. There's a burglar in my heart. Thank you.
Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Discounts not available in all states or situations.